Greetings and welcome back to Room 303 and our Chats with Emily. That's what we're calling our readings through the Johnson edition of the Complete Poems of Emily Dickinson. All 1,775 of these poems is our goal. We're at now poem 209, With Thee in the Desert. And you'll notice that three times we'll have this with thee, with thee, with thee gig going on. This, we think, as we look at it, is probably another poem about absence, about reuniting, about love. But the most obvious question for us will be, who is the thee being referenced in the poem? Now, our assumptions are that you've been following our stuff at learnstrong.net, down that left-hand side, Chats with Emily, our playlist. I'm hopeful that you've already experienced our set of introductory comments, and I'm hopeful that you've already worked through the preceding 208 poems. We just finished with 208, the Rose to Caper. Now, I want you to notice the power of repetition in this very, very short little poem. I mean, and as we have said a number of times, when we get to poem 1063, we'll play that game. Ashes denote that fire was. It's a great line that suggests even short poems can have powerful implications, and I think this is one of them. Note the exotic references to Africa or Asia, and we'll be back with an earlier poem. Some have read this poem as a theodicy, that is to say, the notion of why must there be pain and suffering in the world, and is it possible that after great pain and suffering comes some kind of a relief? Let's enjoy. With thee in the desert, with thee in the thirst, with thee in the tamarind wood, leopard breathes at last. Now, I'm always blown away by the games that Emily will play over time. And, you know, success is counted sweetest by those who ne'er succeed. To comprehend a nectar requires source need. That idea that you only really appreciate how thirsty you are when you are really, really thirsty, right? And that will give you a sense of how important water is. Notice, we don't have any idea who the thee of this poem is. But notice, first, we're in the desert, and you can't help but, of course, when you hear this idea about being in the desert, think about the Matthew 4 passage of Christ in the desert and his suffering there, and the temptations and all of that. With thee in the desert, with thee in the thirst. Now, of course, deserts, dry, thirst. We can't help but think of T.S. Eliot's Wasteland and the Part 5, if there was rock and if there was water in the rock and all of that. We've given full lectures at learnstrong.net on Wasteland, if you want to run that diagram. And then finally, taking us back to poem 73, she mentions this African-Asian tree, the tamarind wood, the fruit tree that has tremendous shade, right? In other words, notice the first two lines are in the desert, in the thirst. And then all of a sudden, we move to sitting under the tamarind tree. And of course, for Emily to mention this is fascinating, because most of anybody who would read this poem would have to Google search to know even, in fact, what this tree we're referencing is. This tree with this huge amount of shade there, with thee and the tamarind. And then all of a sudden, we go to the fourth line with the use of the word leopard. Leopard breathes. And then the dash. And then, at last, with an exclamation point. Now, most people will read this poem as Emily is the leopard, the individual who has allowed for her to be with this individual, now can provide this solace, this peace. Notice, at last. And this idea of at last is going to be central to so many of the poems that we'll study of Emily Dickinson, because it seems to suggest a long time of waiting, 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 and finally, at last, it's going to happen. Well, at 2A, I think the primary message here is obvious. Relief after hard moments, in the end, is precious to us because it seems to happen so seldom. At 2B, obviously, the exotic references here, right? The tamarind and the wood makes sense. At 3A, well, I think that, and I've said this to you guys already, I think there's a lot of Dante standing behind a set of lines like this. Of course, think about what Dante's Divine Comedia is about. We've given full lectures at learnstrong.net. What is that poem really about? Well, it's about learning how to go through hell, not to hell. Yes? In other words, we've got to get through the experience. But I think there's more than that for Dante. Remember the power in our study of Dante's Inferno? Remember the importance of leopards mentioned here? Remember that leopards will rule, right, in circles 8 and 9 of hell. And of course, this idea that there are deserts and thirst as well as we go through the long journey with Dante the Pilgrim and his guide Virgil. Finally, a 3B to own a poem like this. When was a time when you felt this kind of relief? And who was the individual that provided it for you? I'm hopeful that for some of you, this will start to be Emily. Thank you.